Hi, my name is Marek Polit, and I would like to invite you to the 11th part of the Grenton Academy. Here you will learn how virtual objects work and what benefits they give, and how to configure them in the Grenton system. You already know from the previous part of the Academy how we create a configuration in the Grenton system. We can create a configuration using the basic connections between objects, so between inputs and outputs in the system, but we can also create it by using scripts. And by using the scripts, you can create a much more complex configuration with the use of many more objects. Also, with the help of the scripts, you can create function blocks, various types of controllers, which you will use when creating an advanced configuration. To facilitate the configuration process, we have added one more tool to the system, and these are the virtual objects. Generally and simply speaking, virtual objects are ready-made logical blocks which were created inside the system's logic. These blocks, just like the inputs and outputs in the system, have their own features, methods and events, and from the configuration point of view, we will handle and use them exactly as if we were using physical inputs and outputs in modules, but they do not have their physical duplicate. This means that to be able to use a given virtual object, we do not need to add an additional module. It is simply embedded inside the logic of a given device, a given object of CLU class. Virtual objects were created mainly to speed up the configuration process. For example, instead of creating several different scripts which we will use as part of our project, we can use a virtual object which has already been configured in such a way as to perform a given function. You will find various virtual objects in different modules in our system. You can find the most in the CLU mode. From the virtual objects which are available there today, you will find, among others, a timer, calendar, scheduler, but also slightly more advanced objects such as a virtual thermostat, event scheduler, present sensor, sunrise-sunset calendar, or an object which will allow us to send notifications such as push notifications. Gate-type modules, which are also CLU class objects, also have their own virtual objects on the basis of which we will create the configuration in these devices. For example, a gate alarm will have virtual objects corresponding to the management of the zone in the alarm system for its input or output. Depending on whether it's a Jablotron system or a Satel system, you will see different objects there. In the Modbus module, you will find a virtual object to handle Modbus registers, while in the gate HTTP module, you will find object for sending requests or responding to receiving request. We will now move on to the configuration, and you will be able to see how we create these objects in the system and how we use them in the configuration creation process. You can find a full list of virtual objects, their description and configuration methods in the system's manual, which you can download from our website. Now, I'd like to show you some basic and popular virtual objects which you will often use in your setups. Let's start with the most basic object, so the timer object. Before we go to the configuration, quite important information to begin with is, as I said before, different modules have different types of virtual objects. If we want to configure objects specific to the CLU module or, for example, to the gate alarm or gate HTTP, first you have to select the module or one of the devices connected to it. In this case, after selecting the CLU module, I choose the Add Virtual Object button from the top menu, and you can see immediately the list of objects which this CLU module has. Let's start with the first object, which is the timer object. After selecting this object from the list and entering the name, we can go straight to the embedded features of this object. In the embedded features, you will see the name of the mode feature. Mode means the operating status in which the object can work. The timer can work in two modes, the countdown mode and the interval mode. After selecting the operating mode, enter the default time as the initial value for this object. For the purposes of this presentation, we will enter the value of 1000 milliseconds here to quickly show how we will use it. And now going back to work mode. If this timer will work in the countdown mode, the on timer event will be generated after the countdown of 1000 milliseconds. If the timer works in the interval mode, then after counting this value, the event will be generated. And after another countdown of 1000 milliseconds, this event will be generated again. It will be generated every second until we actually stop it. In addition to the on-timer event, you can also see the on-start event here, that being the event that will be generated when this timer starts. On-stop or on-pause, which also depending on whether we stop or pause these events. We will start the configuration from the interval mode. So, as I said before, on this mode, the on-timer event will be generated every set interval until we stop the timer. In this way, we can use the timer, for example, as loops to run a script periodically, every 1, every 2, 5, 10 seconds. Or we can use our timer to simulate alarm lighting using the interval mode. Now we can do such an example configuration to the on-timer event. I will add a lamp, lamp_LED_RGB, with the switch method, which will change the state of the lamp to the opposite after each countdown of the set time. We send the configuration. After sending the configuration, we open the virtual timer object, and in the control, we can see the start, stop, and pause method, or the time setting, and we can immediately control our timer from this window, which means starting our timer. Look, after a 1 second countdown, the lamp state changes to the opposite. Now, in the embedded features, you can see how this time is counted down. And then when stopped, the timer is stopped. Of course, you can start it from any object. We can connect it to the alarm system, to the system input, or to an ordinary switch. The way you configure it is completely up to you. We will now do an example configuration using the countdown mode. In the embedded features, we will change the value to 3 seconds to make it a bit easier to see immediately the effect of the action. Now I would like to use the timer to turn off the lighting for me. So we will do a configuration example in which I turn on the lighting with the switch, and after some time, I would like the system to turn off the light for me. In the events, we have to remember to change the event from switch to switch off, because I would like the system to turn off the lighting for me after the countdown. And another important point, we need to associate the start of the timer with the lamp which I would like the timer to control, so as to turn it off. I choose my LED lamp and then to the on switch on event, so I will assign the start method from my timer to turn it on. And now, after sending a few configurations, when I press the button that turns on the lamp will start the timer, and after the countdown, in this case 3 seconds, the lamp will be turned off. In this way, you can use a timer object, for example, to switch a given device on or off after a preset time has elapsed. Another virtual object which I would like to show you is the event scheduler. The event scheduler is an object which is based on a calendar and allows us to switch on a given device or trigger a given scene or action at a specific time on a specific day of the week. So, just like before, we choose the event scheduler object from the menu and give it a name. I would like my object to function as an alarm clock, so I enter the name alarm clock for it, and now look. In the events, just like in the case of the timer, we have our on start events, on stop, but we also have an on event. So, an event that starts at a specific time on a specified date. And now, during the configuration, we add an action to this event that we would like to trigger. Then in my case, I would like the event scheduler to act as an alarm clock, so I will choose my scene alarm clock from the list of CLU's methods. And we don't really need to configure it anymore from the object manager. Of course, in the embedded features, you will find, among others, a list of rules or the next rule to invoke. In the control, we can add such a rule manually, using the cron rules, while the object is user-friendly enough that when we add it to the mobile interface, the user will be able to set the rules himself and decide at what time the selected scene will be launched. Now let me show you how we add this object to the mobile interface. This is the interface I have already used before. If we wanted to give the user the ability to decide when the scenario will run, just drag it to the selected page, and that's it. After adding my alarm clock, the event scheduler object to the interface page, we send the interface to the mobile device, and now we take a phone. We add an interface to our application and scan the QR code. And at this point, you can see and check how each of you can add rules on the phone. So I would like my alarm clock to switch on every day during the week at 7:15 a.m. I want it to open the roller shutters, turn on the lighting if it's still dark outside, and play my favorite music. The event scheduler is a virtual object which is ideal for launching a function, device, or even a given scenario at a specific time, and a specific time of the day. If we would like the system to automatically implement certain scenarios at sunrise and sunset, we can use the sunrise-sunset calendar object for this purpose. We create it in the same way as before. We also select the CLU module for which we want to create this object, and select the sunrise-sunset calendar object from the list, and add a name to it. I would like my astronomical clock to control the operation of the roller shutters. So I will name it Roller Shutter Clock. And now, look, we go straight to the events. In the addition to the typical events for objects such as on start or on stop, we have four very interesting events here. On sunrise event, so for the sunrise, on sunset for the sunset, and day and night events. The on sunrise event will be triggered at sunrise, but we can set the offset in the embedded features. If we want some functions in the system to run for half an hour before the sun rises, or half an hour after it rises, add the offset here, and this event will be just triggered with the sunrise time plus or minus the assumed offset. In my case, if I wanted the sunrise-sunset calendar to automatically open the roller shutters at sunrise, I would add the open roller shutters script to the on sunrise event. And similarly, if I wanted this clock to close the roller shutters after sunrise, I would add the close roller shutter script to the on sunset event. The system will automatically, depending on the season, keep the roller shutters open when the sun appears in the sky and close them when it gets dark. Another thing that we need to set when adding the sunrise sunset calendar object is the longitude and latitude for our location, because the sunrise and sunset times will vary depending on where we are. So now we need to set these parameters for our location. We'll start with the latitude. I have already checked that the latitude where Krakow is located has this value. And now we will give the longitude. And at this point, after sending the configuration, the system itself will take care of my roller shutters, open them at sunrise and close at sunset. Of course, you can use this object for many other purposes, for example to turn on the lighting on the facade, or like before, to the alarm clock scenario, if you like to get up quite early. The last virtual object which I would like to discuss today is a push object. Although the push object has already been presented in the episode regarding the mobile application, I would like you to also see how we create it from the configuration side. we start as before. So also select the push object from the list of objects. I'll add a name to it. I would like the system to inform me when a flooding is detected. So I name this object push flooding. Now, going to the embedded features, you can see the two important features, message and title. Since the message will be quite important, for me it will be a task, a rather critical event in the system, so it will be entitled alert. So the message I receive then will be kitchen flooding. After creating the push object, the next thing we will associate with this object is to notify us about the occurrence of the event. In my case, it will be a flood sensor located in the kitchen. Let's go to the events because the sensor it uses works in a normally closed technology. So when a flood is detected, I will use the on switch off event so as to turn it off. For the on switch off event, we select the push virtual object we have just created from the list and select the send method. And now, after sending the configuration, the system will send messages about the event, so about my alert, to those mobile devices for which we have allowed to receive messages in the settings. How can we check if our devices have been given such consent? We open the mobile interface, and then in the settings we can see if the given push object is selected for our interface. This way we can decide which users should receive which messages. You can also set up push notifications in the system for different actions and different situations. The system can inform you about an alarm event, just like a moment ago. In my case, after detecting a flood, you can receive a notification that something is wrong in your home. But it can also inform you that the children have just returned home, or that someone, by accident, turned off the alarm clock you set earlier. As you have seen, virtual objects speed up the configuration process a lot. We've covered just a few of them in this episode, but I encourage you to check them all out and see how they can help you set up your systems. Thank you for your attention, and I would like to invite you to the next episode in which I will tell you about the Grenton Multisensor module, its possibilities, and how we can use it.